Santa Susana Field Laboratory in Southern California, Simi Hills, is a complex of industrial research and development facilities. Was mainly used for the testing and development of liquid propellant rocket engines for the United States space program from 1949 to 2006, also nuclear reactors from 1953 to 1980, and the operation of U.S. government-sponsored liquid metals research center from 1966 to 1998. Since 1947, the Santa Susana Field Laboratory location has been used by a number of companies and agencies. First, there was Rocketdyne, originally a division of North American Aviation, which developed a variety of pioneering, successful, and reliable liquid rocket engines. Then it was bought by the Boeing Company, who became the primary owner and operator. Facility dedicated to the development and testing of nuclear reactors, powerful rockets such as the Delta II and the systems that powered the Apollo missions. The location was chosen in 1947 for its remoteness. However, they had no idea that Southern California would grow as fast as it did. They had rocket engine development, nuclear energy and research and development, sodium reactor experiments, energy technology engineering center. The sodium reactor experiment was an experimental nuclear reactor which operated from 1957 to 1964 and was the first commercial power plant in the world to experience a core meltdown. There was a decades-long cover-up by the U.S. Department of Energy. The operation predated environmental regulation, so early disposal techniques are not recorded in detail. Thousands of pounds of sodium coolant from the time of the meltdown are not yet accounted for. Accidents and site contamination. Throughout the years, approximately 10 low-power nuclear reactors operated at the facility in addition to several critical facilities, a sodium burn pit in which sodium-coated objects were burned in an open pit, a plutonium fuel fabrication facility, a uranium carbide fuel fabrication facility, and the purportedly largest hot lab facility in the United States at that time. A hot lab is a facility used for remotely cutting up irradiated nuclear fuel. The hot lab suffered a number of fires involving radioactive materials. For example, in 1957, a fire in the hot cell got out of control and massive contamination resulted. Sodium graphite reactor, quarterly progress report, January through March of 1957. In July 1959, the site suffered a partial nuclear meltdown that has been named the worst in U.S. history, releasing an undisclosed amount of radiation, but thought to be much more than the Three Mile Island disaster in 1979. Another radioactive fire occurred in 1971, involving combustible primary reactor coolant contaminated with mixed fission products. At least 4 of the 10 nuclear reactors suffered accidents. The AE-6 reactor experienced a release of fission gases in March 1959. The SRE experienced a power excursion and partial meltdown in July 1959. The SNAP 8ER in 1964 experienced damage to 80% of its fuel, and the SNAP 8DR in 1969 experienced similar damage to 1/3 of its fuel. The reactors located on the grounds were considered experimental and therefore had no containment structures. reactors and highly radioactive components were housed without the large concrete domes that surround modern power reactors. The sodium burn pit, an open-air pit for cleaning sodium-contaminated components, was also contaminated when radioactivity and chemically contaminated items were burned in it, in contravention of safety requirements. In an article noted that 27 men on Palmer's crew, 22 of those gentlemen died of cancers. On some nights, Palmer returned home from work and kissed his wife hello, only to burn her lips with the chemicals he had breathed at work. Sometimes the water was so polluted it bubbled. The fish died off. They had 7 wells up there, water wells, and every damn one of them was contaminated. It was a horror story, and still is. Other spills and releases occurred over the decades of the operation as well. In 1989, a DOE investigation found widespread chemical and radioactive contamination on the property. Widely publicized in the local press, the revelations led to substantial concern among community members and elected officials, resulting in a challenge to and subsequent shutdown of continued nuclear activity at the site and the filing of lawsuits. Cleanup commenced, and the United States Environmental Protection Agency was brought in at the request of local legislators to provide oversight. On December 2002, a top DOE official, Mike Lopez, described typical cleanup procedures executed by field lab employees in the past. Workers would dispose of barrels filled with highly toxic waste by shooting the barrels with rifles so that they would explode and release their contents into the air. It was unclear when this process ended, but for certain did end prior to the 1990s. Wow. On July 26, 1994, two scientists were killed when the chemicals they were illegally burning in open pits exploded. After a grand jury investigation, the FBI raid on the facility, 3 Ruckadyne officials pleaded guilty in the June 2004 to illegally storing explosive materials. At trial, a retired Ruckadyne mechanic testified as to what he witnessed at the time of the explosion. I assumed we were burning waste, Wells testified, comparing the process used on July 21 and 26 in 1994 to that once used to legally dispose of leftover chemicals at the company's old burn pit. As Heine poured the chemicals for what would have been the third burn of the day, the blast occurred. The background noise was so loud I didn't hear anything. I felt the blast, and I looked down, and my shirt was coming apart. When he realized what had occurred, Wells said, I felt to see if I was all there. I knew I was burned, but I didn't know how bad. In 2005, wildfires swept through northern Los Angeles County and parts of Ventura County. The fires consumed most of the dry brush throughout the Simi Hills, where the facility is located, and it did receive substantial fire damage. Since the fire, allegations have emerged that vast quantities of on-site contamination were released yet again into the air. Most recently, Los Angeles County firefighters who were assigned to the facility during the fire have been sent for medical testing to see if any harmful doses were ingested or inhaled while protecting the facility. While community members and firefighters have expressed concern about the amount of exposure, Boeing officials stand by their position that no contamination of the air resulted from the fire, and that any contamination that may have been consumed by the fire was negligible. Of course they're going to say that. California Department of Toxic Substances Control also claims that no significant contamination occurred as a result of the fire. Although the field lab is under current criticism for violating almost 50 discharge permits, state agencies have been silent on the issue. Recently, lawmakers disclosed to the California State Water Resources Control Board that over 80 exceedances of Boeing's discharge permits were found in the preceding year alone. In January 2006, the State Water Resources Control Board finally stepped in and refused some requests by Boeing for even tighter standards. And yes, they've had medical claims. But let me see. In regards to the... Wait, here's the cleanup. During its years of operation, widespread use occurred of highly toxic chemical additives to power over 30,000 rocket engine tests and to clean the rocket test stands afterwards. Regarding cleanup, the site's current owner is Boeing, with NASA and DOE liable for several parcels within that. On August 2005, Pratt & Whitney purchased Boeing's Rocketdyne division, but declined to acquire Santa Susana as part of the sale. Then they had runoff issues, which Boeing's explanation, it's all coming from natural radioactivity, not from us. Of course not. And if this isn't enough, 2007, Boeing announced that in a landmark agreement between Boeing and California officials, nearly 2,400 acres of land will become state parkland. Won't that be nice? The property will be donated and preserved as a vital, undeveloped open space link in the Simi Hills above Simi Valley. The agreement will permanently restrict the land for non-residential, non-commercial use. How would you want to go for a walk in a toxic park with your children and your pets, your dog? Go walk your dog? Ooh. Boy, thanks, Gov Arnie. That's really looking out for us. Of course, he doesn't really care. He's above all us. Okay. So they did pass a law in 2007 that set the standards for the site's cleanup. But as far as I am aware, they won't start that until 2017. Yeah. Cleanup is projected to be completed in 2017, but I heard they had to push that back. Maybe I'm wrong. Don't know how they're going to clean it up. And yes, there is a lot of community involvement, but you never hear anything about this. I live right near this. You don't ever hear anything about this. Of course. Why would you? All right. As always, God bless and stay safe.